This is Grace Notes. I'm Alan Button, and pleased to have as our guest today, Stephanie Pridgen. And for those of you who have followed Grace Notes for some time now, you might recognize that name. Stephanie was one of our guests some 5 years ago now. Stephanie, welcome.
Thank you.
It's a little bit unusual, as I think most of our listeners know, to have follow-up conversations with our guests, but we wanted to make an exception with Stephanie because Stephanie has got close connections with Ukraine, and Ukraine, needless to say, is at the forefront of the minds of many of us. Stephanie, maybe you could, if you would, just remind us or fill us in again on how you got connected with Ukraine.
So I first went to Ukraine back in 2009. I was part of a missions trip that traveled the world. Ukraine was one of my stops, so I was there for about a month working with university students and fell in love with the country, with the people, and ended up moving back. And I lived there for about 3.5 years and worked with university students there in Ukraine, in Kyiv.
Tell us what the time period was. What years did that 3.5 year stint cover?
I moved there in 2011, and I moved back in 2014.
And you were telling me, actually, that you have been there since back in 2016 for a wedding, as I recall?
Yeah, I went back for a few weeks. I consider her my Ukrainian sister, Ina. She was getting married. So I went back and was able to be there for a few weeks, but sadly I have not been back on the ground since, but I've kept in touch with a number of people.
Yeah, I was about to say, I know from talking with you that you have stayed closely connected with a good number of people there in Ukraine, and maybe you could just tell us what means of communication you use to stay in touch.
So for the most part, we use like Facebook, Instagram, as a way of communication. I still get several newsletters from different ministries and organizations and keep up with them that way.
And I suppose it goes without saying that what has gone on, what is going on over there has been something of great concern to you, as it is with a lot of us.
Definitely. There's been some pretty hard to sleep nights and a lot of kind of communication throughout the days. And, there kind of literally is a sense of life and death urgency in it. And so it's kind of hard to, if you see a message, not look and see if there's something that's, you know, needed and can possibly something you can help with. So
I'd like to come back in a few minutes to maybe have you share, if you would, some specifics or some examples about your communications and what you know about what's going on over there, and maybe talk a little bit, too, about kind of your big picture perspective on it all. But before we do that, tell us about that first song, Peace, Love, and Understanding. And I guess that's not really the full title. by Elvis Costello and the Attractions.
What's so funny about Peace, Love, and Understanding? It's a song from the 70s, and in the beginning of the song, it talks about walking through the wicked world, searching for light in the darkness of insanity, and asking myself, is all hope lost? Is there only pain, hatred, and misery? And that kind of first verse really caught me when I heard it. Because the world just feels insane right now, mm-hmm. You know, and looking at this a measure of it seems just completely unbelievable, and evil, and it would be easy to kind of lose hope in a sense, if you're just looking at the pain and the senselessness of all of it. And I had read, actually looking into it, I had read it, it was almost kind of a joke that this song started off of. But then he kind of felt like he was onto something. And I was like, no, like, really, what's so, it was kind of that idea of making fun of hippies for being all peace, love, and understanding. And it was like, but no, we're kind of onto something. What's so funny about that?
Like maybe
we really need peace, love, and understanding. You know, this is senseless to be killing people and taking away people's lives for what?
Maybe not such a bad idea to talk about peace, love, and understanding. Let's hear it. What's so funny about Peace, Love, and Understanding by Elvis Costello and the Attractions. This is Grace Notes. If you're just joining us, our guest today is Stephanie Pridgen. Stephanie, a longtime student of Ukraine and, in fact, a resident during part of her life of Ukraine. Stephanie, I said that we'd like to hear something about specifics or maybe some examples of your communications, what you've learned, what you are learning from those good number of people that you've stayed in contact with in Ukraine. Can you tell us what you're hearing?
So first off, when the war started 3 weeks ago, or intensified, I was getting several messages from people just kind of in shock and disbelief, of course, as I think most of the world was. A lot of the communications I've had with people have been either around them trying to get somewhere where they felt safer, whether that be across the border or somewhere more west in the country, since that is kind of seen as, you know, the safer place for now. I have a number of former students I'm still in contact with that they don't personally live in Ukraine at the moment because of, you know, where life has taken them, but their family is still there and checking in with them. There's been a lot of talk also about aid and how to help them best, different ways that they are coming together and working to do what's best for their country and themselves and the people around them. I have a number of good friends who have stayed in Ukraine and are helping get aid to the east or to refugees that, you know, have fled their homes and don't know if they'll have somewhere to go back to.
And I'm guessing those conversations about aid involve both big picture sort of national, international aid, as well as the very personal on the ground kind of aid.
Yes, I have a number of different organizations from when I lived there and worked there, you know, that I know personally and have connections to that I feel comfortable with recommending to people. Of course, the larger aid organizations that people at large know. And then I have some friends that, you know, I have their personal bank account numbers and can transfer money directly to them to help. And I've done that in a few instances to help them, whether it be with their family or friends that needed either food or to get somewhere and needed the money to do that. There are just so many needs in a situation like this, and it can be overwhelming, but it's one of those things where nobody can do everything, but everybody can do something. So just been trying to help do that and connect people in whatever way I can to whatever is on their heart to do.
You were telling me a little bit ago about a post that you saw from some friends whose village was just battered by the Russians. Is that something that you'd be able, willing to share?
Well, I've several friends whose hometowns have been invaded. Some of them still have family there, but I believe the one you're speaking about, it was a ministry partner not too far outside of Kyiv that works with orphans and at-risk youth. And they had actually kind of gone pretty quiet as far as how the kids were doing and what was going on for several days. And yesterday, they were able to successfully get the kids out safely, and they are in the western part of the country trying to figure out next steps and paperwork and all of that. But today, maybe just a couple of hours ago, they had posted a picture of their home and ministry site, and the Russian forces had come in and kicked in the doors and windows and destroyed a bunch of property and raided supplies. They took like a $15,000 generator that helped run the camp, and that kind of thing, you know, that they've heard from their neighbors. This is somewhere, you know, that, I mean, they're set up to help people, and the ones that they're helping, you know, they've had to run for their lives, and thankfully they're out and they weren't there and nobody was hurt in all of this. But it just seems so senseless, you know, it's just heartbreaking.
Maybe shifting gears a little bit, Stephanie, what's your sense about the accuracy of the information that the rest of the world is getting outside of perhaps Russia or China with regard to the impact on the Ukrainians and the needs there? And I have in part in mind President Zelensky's address just on Wednesday to the U.S. Congress.
I honestly don't follow Western media too closely, and I haven't for years. Of course, I am following the media. Most of what I've been getting has been from friends that are Ukrainian.
First-hand witnesses.
Right. You know, ones that are hearing shelling and, you know, experiencing this, not sleeping and all of that. You know, it takes a lot of work to go through media accounts and figure out what to believe, what if there's an angle, you know, and all of that. It actually takes a lot of brain power and work, and can sometimes be overwhelming, especially in situations like this. I think it's been said that one of the first casualties of war is the truth. And so I know that propaganda is a thing. It's kind of become a word that has come up a lot now, again. And it's something I think even in the West we have to be aware of. But also, you know, we're in an interesting age where now with social media and the technology we have, you know, my Ukrainian friends and their friends and family, they have cell phones. They can take video and photos and real-time upload. You know, like this is what's happening to us right here and right now. And so I think that's an interesting thing that we're having to look through and process that hasn't been as much before, if that makes sense.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, what I see from my Ukrainian friends, and I know Zelensky has said it again and again, is a call for a no-fly zone, because they're doing an amazing job on the ground of holding their own and not giving in. It's really kind of like a modern day David and Goliath scenario, because, you know, Russia is definitely Goliath, but the bombs, the shelling that's coming from the air is what's just totally decimating places.
What you're talking about reminds me, too, of some of the history of that country. In fact, let me go back just for a minute to something that you said a few minutes ago. You said something about when the war started, and then you paused and said, or intensified. Why did you do that?
Well, if you would talk to my Ukrainian friends and as far as I'm concerned as well, really the war started 8 years ago.
2014,
when Russia came in and grabbed Crimea and claimed it, then, you know, came into the Donbas region, and there's been fighting there for 8 years now. And myself and many of my Ukrainian friends said then that it wouldn't end there. And it's one of those things where you're like, you never want to be right about something like that. But it just kind of, it has been a sore subject, I know, with my Ukrainian friends, that it has seemingly been like, this war just started, when in reality it didn't just start. It started 8 years ago, and it has just very, very much intensified in the last 3 weeks to a place that I don't think many of us are that surprised that it has come to this, but it's also, you really hoped you were wrong that it, you know, that it wouldn't come to this. And we would say we don't believe that it would stop with Ukraine, and that's, again, a place that you hope you're wrong, but, you know.
Let's talk about this next song that you've selected. Why Eye of the Tiger?
So Eye of the Tiger, one, it's just a really good song.
you like the melody, you like the rhythm.
You know, yeah.
Makes you want to dance.
Yeah, it's one of those ones that you can sing along with, and it's just one of those really good 80s songs.
it makes you want to be in the middle of the boxing ring and punch the air.
It just makes you want to take somebody down.
for those of our listeners who might not know, it was the theme song for Rocky III. Go ahead, Stephanie.
Yeah, so, you know, in the lyrics, I'm really big on lyrics, and it talks about rising up to the challenge of our rival, and there's one part, rising up straight to the top, had the guts, got the glory, went the distance, now I'm not going to stop, just a man and his will to survive. And to me, while it's not just a good song, it really just makes me think of my friends in Ukraine and Ukraine as a nation. I think a lot of people have been very surprised by the response of Ukrainians and how they have really said, no, this is our country, this is our land, and We don't care how big your army is. Like, we're gonna stand up and we're gonna fight. And you know, they've got a will to survive. They are very strong people, and I think a lot of that comes from their culture. You know, their country has a history of people coming in trying to conquer them and trying to make their identity something else, and they are very strong in who they are, and, you know, it's, we are Ukrainian and this is our land, and I deeply respect that, you know, as much as I want people safe, I deeply respect that willingness to stand and fight for their country and their people.
And from our perspective, for what looks like fighting for the right.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you're right. Surprised and just inspired by what we're seeing. Let's hear it. Eye of the Tiger by Survivor. Well, Stephanie, we're a bit short on time, but I'd like, if you would, to maybe wrap up by saying something about what you think we regular folks should know and maybe do.
So I would say, you know, I think no one can do everything, but everyone can do something. You know, you're seeing images and video, I'm sure, on the news and social media, and they're devastating to see, but all hope is not lost, even though it may feel that way in some moments. And even those of us who are not in Ukraine, and even if you don't know someone personally, there are things you can do. You know, you can reach out to your government leaders, you can find someone that is doing something good, a trusted organization, and you know, you can help in that way. You can help spread the word, and Ukraine is watching. You know, my friends are watching, and they have told me, you know, they appreciate when they see people posting their support and helping to share what's going on. And sending, even if it's a little something, they recognize how much that helps.
That's good to know. It says something about the value of just the relationship, being in touch and encouraging and cheering on, in effect. And I noticed that you've got a necklace on that maybe relates to what you're talking about. Can you describe it for our listeners?
Yeah, so my necklace is it's a fused glass Ukrainian flag that was given to me by a Ukrainian friend several years ago, and I've been wearing it. It's my kind of way of showing everyone, in case people didn't know where I stand, you know, that I'm with them.
Very nice. You described for me, kind of by way of metaphor, I guess, your view of how the Ukrainians are handling this, which I think is another ground for inspiration, talking about them as you might see bees functioning in a bee colony?
Yeah, so that was actually an analogy I came across from a professor who's at Kyiv Mohyla. And he shares a lot of his thoughts. A university
mm-hmm. there in Kyiv.
And I've been following him for eight some years now. But there's kind of been this analogy of Ukraine as a beehive. And, you know, bees don't sting unless you threaten them. So there's kind of that part of it. But then also, like, bees, if you ever watch kind of a beehive, everyone has a part, and they're doing their part to make it work. And I think that's something that a lot of people have seen, is how even just everyday citizens have come together and are doing what they can, you know, if it's putting together Molotov cocktails, if it's, you know, I've got a car so I can help carry people from one place to another, or try to help evacuate people, or try to get them supplies, you know, and there, it's this whole network that is happening. And, you know, my feed is filled with people of, hey, do you know somebody in this area that can do this? Send me a private message, give them my phone number, you know, and it's like all these little connections that are happening to make a big impact. And that's really a strength that you see that is happening. And a lot of the reason why they are being so effective at holding their ground is because everyone has just they're doing their part and doing what they can. And it's a pretty astounding to see.
Yeah, and a great example to all of us about what it means to come together.
Yeah.
Tell us about this third song that we've got coming up, Tears for Ukraine.
Tears.
And I know, by the way, it's a new one. It was just produced very recently.
Yeah, so I actually just heard it for the first time myself just a few minutes ago. And there's a video that goes along with it. And, you know, it is basically a prayer, you know, watching what is happening and being in tears to see what is happening and praying for better days ahead.
Yeah, I think one of the lines in it is, my prayers tonight will include tears for Ukraine.
Yeah. And my prayers every night have included tears for Ukraine the last several weeks. And I don't think I'm alone.
It's a powerful song because it talks about the very human impact of what's going on over there.
Right.
From little kids to grandmothers and grandfathers.
Which is affecting the whole world. Because, I mean, you've got a refugee population in the millions now that is coming into other countries, I'm sure even our country, and you've got the effects that will be felt for the rest of people's lives, you know. So there's a lot to pray for.
Good place to end, I think, Stephanie. Thank you for coming in. It's been really special to have you return and talk to us.
Thank you for having me again.
Let's hear it. Tears for Ukraine. And it's a song by Billy Craig, Matt Jacobs, and Eric Rhodes, featuring Elsie Binks.
Reluctantly I turn out today's tragic news.